Has everyone noticed what good vibes there are in here today? I love Peter Urpeth's, I love Peter Urpeth's phrase, Joyce in the Garret. This is the new Garret right here, top of Foyles over Charing Cross Road. So I actually had 2.5 bottles of pink wine with Jill. Where's Jill? There she is over there last night. So I'm not going to extemporise. I'm going to read it out. Otherwise, I'll dry up entirely. So all I want to say is that this is obviously a very exciting era with new digital possibilities opening up every month, it seems. And that is fabulous. Of course it is. And it sometimes feels as if we're hardly in control of those developments. And that in itself is fun too, and it's probably good for us. But we can still influence a few things to some extent sometimes, which means that it's incumbent upon us to influence them if we can discern a way of steering those things for the better, such as making sure that this brave new publishing scene is fully on view and celebrated in all its variety. So here's a question just to throw into the mix. One characteristic of this era is that secret and mysterious non-human algorithms increasingly act as virtuous spirals of market power, perhaps more than ever before. But let's stand back from those less human processes and consider an equally important wider question. That question is, how can we ensure the longer-term good health, financial and cultural, of a sector of human endeavour whose richness and interest depend on the flourishing of a diversity of fiction categories, not just the handful of categories that happen to sell at the highest volume? Solving this would benefit many really good writers whose voices would otherwise go unheard, but more importantly, it would also benefit readers and the wider culture. It goes without saying that all fiction categories are created equal in themselves with equal value and loveliness. But in both independent and traditional publishing these days, titles in literary and cross-genre categories are under more pressure than ever to justify their existence in terms of purely commercial competition with more mass market genres. Pure market forces are fine as far as they go, but they do seem to be this digital dynamic's main source of oxygen so far. And their nature just happens to ensure that only certain kinds of content tend to get organically promoted for any given level of time or effort or money that's available to be expended. And those kinds of content are all fine and beautiful in themselves, just as much as the more literary fiction categories. But the resultant incompleteness in the picture of the kinds of creative output that are really being published is something that should be revealed and addressed. It's often lamented that the variety and quirkiness of places like London's Soho and downtown Manhattan have suffered a big diminishment in recent years, as unique venues have been priced out and pushed out by well-lit, well-heated new branches of favorite high street chain stores that are already popular and well-trafficked everywhere else too. Echoing that gentrification process, the combination of retail algorithms and the media's frequent focus on sales-oriented reporting tends to cause commercial fiction categories, beautiful as those are, to push literary fiction categories out of comparable visibility to a greater extent in independent publishing than in traditional publishing. This is not the fault of commercial fiction authors themselves, of course, but in any field, if certain categories of activity in that field have a tendency to end up effectively hidden from general view, then the landscape of that field starts looking quite a bit less richly varied than it really is. Unnecessarily so. This does not need to be the case if we put our heads together to address it. Many a Starbucks branch has displaced many an indie coffee shop. Both make equally excellent coffees and both are equally attractive in their own different ways. But what shall we and the media come up with in order to make sure that the fiction category equivalents of the small indie coffee shop, e.g. literary fiction, including its more envelope-pushing varieties, but not only these, can remain commercially viable alongside the Starbucks-level profits that more commercial categories of fiction are already smartly achieving through indie publishing? New organizations, new coalitions, perhaps? All fiction categories are created equal, but in this current exciting era, some categories tend to get edged out of visibility, in independent publishing at least, in favor of others. And this edging out is in fact a powerful shaper of the culture, so prevalent that it is able to hide in plain view, like an elephant in a room. Dan and I would therefore like to shine a light on this elephant. It's over there, Dan. It's over there in the corner. I'll just close by saying that in urban planning, clever zoning innovations are sometimes introduced either to preserve or adapt the character of a retail district to preserve its variety, but without being too restrictive on businesses large or small. Is some media equivalent of such zoning possible here? These innovations must surely be achievable, and they must be achieved proactively. We just haven't found them yet. So let's find them.
I want to answer a slightly more general question, which is, why should the self-publishing community protect and promote the complete diversity of literature? And I'm a poet, so this is a poem. Because every day, a little girl, let's call her Sarah, hears the world condensed into words and falls in love with a possibility that she might fold her life into a gift of syllables and sentences and hold it out to all the sisters, misfits, lonely souls and drifters to open and unfold towards a beautiful horizon they had always thought hopelessly distant. Because when her parents see the way she looks, they sigh and go to bed and cry because they know tomorrow they will take Sarah to a place every kid she knows believes is magical, a bookshop. Because they know when she reaches her beautiful black hand to the mirror of the shelf, she'll see not herself, but my white hand reflected back. Because tomorrow's books are written by the choices we make today. Their pages penned by voices we invite to stay, not voices that we turn away. Because when we set our sights only on our own freedom, the light we see at the end of the tunnel is a metaphor, systemically generated by a literary hegemony to strengthen the advantages of an already charmed existence, to keep others at arm's length and their chances at a manageable distance. Because what we call quality, others here as colony, whose overlords behead the aspirations of others with ceremonial swords like approving badges, nodding column inches, blogging and awards. Because when we pick and choose the facts of writing right, the tropes and tools of narrative exactitude to ensure Sarah loses when she enacts her life, perhaps the syntax we use is wrong. Because if we want to uncage every song, be fibers of a fabric where every thread belongs, it is our duty to take these microphones and these tweets and empty them of middle-aged white guys like me and hold the door as we withdraw and Sarah takes the floor and unrolls the carpet woven from the warp of her words and the weft of her dreams and waits with open pages for the sisters, misfits, lonely souls and drifters as their lives follow her onto the heart-lifting, dream-shifting, gloriously glittering stage.